enormous bundles of sandbags, ready-made up duck boards, and worst of all, barbed wire.
It was always hard work. You were a bonny labouring boy more than you were a fighter.
All the chaps were very tired, but it made no difference.
And they were mentally tired out. They'd just come out of a trench tour for a rest, and this was the kind of rest they were getting.
They would be, say, 2 miles behind the line.
We wanted to neutralize enemy batteries, so we were registering our batteries on his.
We used to know the line and elevation because it was done by aircraft.
It's pretty ghastly, but the idea was to kill as many German gunners as you could.
There was no motorised transport then for guns. The guns used to be brought out by horses.
There was to be no preliminary bombardment for days beforehand. There was only one short, sharp barrage just before the battle.
You've got to have the artillery preparation to smash their wire down.
I ordered fire on possible enemy assembly and forming up positions.
The bombardment started. And the ground shook. And we could see the hundreds and hundreds of gun flashes. As soon as the bombardment started, the Germans' retaliation came. For 4 hours, we had to sit there and take everything he slung at us.
At any given moment, we could expect to be shelled. And you got very little protection against that.
And then you'd hear a mild pop as the gun fired 5 miles away. Very good. Yeah. And in the 5 or 6 seconds it took for him to come, you can pass through quite a number of psychological changes.
I can't remember anything more nerve-wracking than the continuous shelling without stop day and night.
Well, we were always told that you never heard the shell that hit you because most of them travelled faster than sound.
You could literally feel your heart pounding against the ground. The emotional strain was absolutely terrific.
Although a shell might burst 50 yards away, you might find a fragment of jagged iron, nearly red hot and weighing half a pound, arriving in your trench.